Hey everybody, Reed here. Welcome to yet another Vintage Cube Draft here on channelfireball.com. I'm going to level with you. I didn't intend to record more than one Vintage Cube Draft, but I had so much fun the first time that let's keep it going. I hope you don't mind. Before I get to that, I'll remind you that you can join us over at CFB Pro. That's all part of the bigger TCG player subscription, which includes store credit back on your orders, free shipping on direct, all that good stuff. I have it myself. And then thanks also to Ultimate Guard for sponsoring me and my teammates. Let's fire up a Vintage Cube Draft. Oh, seven in the queue. You love to see it. Must be my lucky day already. What's it going to be? Black Lotus, Soul Ring, Time Walk. No Black Lotus, Soul Ring, or Time Walk. So I have Elvish Mystic. I never mind just starting a draft with a green mana dork. There's Grief, which is quite good. Hex Drinker is quite good. Not going to take Niv-Mizzet, but sometimes it's fun to keep an eye on that for the wheel. Chrome Mox is good and keeps you open. I don't think I'd first pick Glorybringer, but that's a good card as well. Underground Sea. I usually like to have a power card before I take the Spellseeker, though that card's really good sometimes. Okay, so narrowing it down to Elvish Mystic, Grief, Hex Drinker, Chrome Mox, or Underground Sea. Could see an argument for any of those. I'm going to go with Chrome Mox because it does keep me open to pretty much anything. All right. Well, Palace Jailer is excellent, and I do particularly like Chrome Mox in sort of the white aggressive or mid-range decks. Nissa is one of the best green cards in the cube, though Chrome Mox I think is a little worse in green because a lot of the cards that you would be pitching to Chrome Mox would be accelerating your mana anyway. Umezawa's Jitte, this was my first pick in the last cube draft, although I ended up not playing it at all. Then there's Brain Freeze, which is one of the most fun options to get you started on the Storm track. Prismatic Vista as well. So I think Palace Jailer is a good mix of pairing well with my first pick and just being an objectively really strong card. You could make the same case for the Umezawa's Jitte, and then I would still be open to, like, say, Mono Red. Yeah, I don't think I'm going to take the... Yeah, I think it's one of those, Jailer or Jitte. All right, I'm going with the Jitte. I had a change of heart at the last minute, just wanted to stay a little bit more open. And it's... Okay, if I had taken Palace Jailer, I'd probably be on Recruiter of the Guard here, but I do think there are some better options. Like, I'm a big fan of Chandra, Birds of Paradise. Narset's really good. If I had taken a blue card in my first two picks, I'd be excited about Narset, but with Umezawa's Jitte, I think I want to go in a different direction. So Chandra or Birds? Chandra or Birds? The start of like Hex Drinker, Nissa, and Birds of Paradise would be really nice too. But even having picked the colorless cards, I think I should just kind of move on the third pick, Birds of Paradise. Maybe I'll be fortunate enough to wheel a green card for my first pack. Oh boy, now this is interesting. Eternal Witness is fine. Probably not quite strong enough to take it from this pack. Balance is a really great card. Wheel of Fortune is a really great card. Deceiver Exarch. Balance, Wheel of Fortune. I think I'm going to take Balance and just see how things go from there. Solitude, Winter Orb. Don't think these green cards are strong enough to take. I'm gonna grab the Solitude, and yeah, probably should have just had like Palace Jailer, Recruiter of the Guard, Solitude. That would probably be my ideal start, given these first five packs. Gideon Jura, Odonto Vanguard. I guess I'll take Odonto Vanguard. It's a little. This is like not a card that I'm happy to move into White Weenie for. I'd rather just be solidified in White Weenie and get this late. But I do think it's probably the best pick from this pack. Pestermite and Thirst for Discovery are much stronger cards, but I'd rather match my color at this point. All right, Flickerwisp. Totally fine with that. So if it was Chrome Mox, Palace Jailer, Recruiter of the Guard, I mean, the reason I picked the Jitte is this is also a great card in White Weenie. You can even get Stoneforge Mystic, but it's probably, well, I don't know. I don't know if it's as good as Palace Jailer. Jitte is great. Some people just swear by the Palace Jailer and totally love it. I don't really know about that pick. But the Birds of Paradise, I guess, was just a minor bump in the road that I probably won't play, though there's nothing to stop me from playing just white green. Could have had a decent red deck too if I'd taken the Chandra and then started taking all the red cards. Wow, Elvish Mystic and Hex Drinker both wheeling. So somebody took the Underground Sea. Somebody took the Spell Seeker. I'm gonna take Elvish Mystic, and now I don't know what to do. This is such a weird draft. It's like white's open, green's open, red's open. Everybody's fighting for Reanimator or something like that. Well, I guess I could just build a white deck, I could build a green deck, or I could build a white green deck, and I'm fine with any of those three options. I used to do this more in Legacy Cube and not Vintage Cube, but if you just do like a white green deck with non-land sources of mana and then you get Armageddon and Ravages of War, that's pretty nice. The old Urnamgeddon archetype for those of you who are old school players. Toski could be cool, but given the start, I'll take Horizon Canopy. That's basically going to go in my deck 100% of the time. Recruiter of the Guard wheeled. Restoration Angel wheeled. I think I take that over the Razor Verge Thicket because I can just be mono white if things go that way. Okay, probably not using any of these. Court of Bounty. I think I've had a bad experience with this card, but I guess there's probably no way I get to hunt Master of the Fells from here anyway. Wow, last pick, Goblin Guide. Switch to mono red after the cleave and the Goblin Guide. No, I'm happy. I'm happy with my white deck. This is going fine. Just missed out on the Palace Jailer, but no harm done. All right. Sword of Fire and Ice. Channel for my green deck. Gideon, Adeline, Figure of Destiny. So I think what I would like to do is basically hope to get two out of three of these white cards. So I'm going to use my normal drafting heuristic of just taking the cheapest card. In fact, a one drop that scales in the late game is really high value in cube. I particularly like Figure of Destiny. So I'm going to take that and then hope that either the Gideon or the Adeline are still in the pack when it comes around. Or even the Sword of Fire and Ice, you know, if I wound up with a Stoneforge Mystic deck. Channel is the most powerful card, but I kind of like my white weenie track more than my green track. Now we have Parallax Wave, Elspeth Conquers Death, and I guess Relic of Progenitus. Parallax Wave is really nice. I think Elspeth Conquers Death is better. I think this is just like an amazing card in Cube Draft. Also, the Parallax Wave, I think, has a higher chance of wheeling because anyone with white mana will play Elspeth Conquers Death, and only an aggressive white deck will play Parallax Wave. Wow, White Plume Adventurer. Banned in Legacy. Legal in Cube Draft. All right. Giver of Runes over Lurrus. I think I have too many strong high mana value cards to use the Lurrus at this point. But if it wheels, I'll put it in my deck. Same with the Mishra's Factory. I can't believe the old version of Elspeth. I like the old version of Elspeth, but I can't believe it's still in the cube when the new version of Elspeth is so much stronger. I'm going to take Usher of the Fallen. This is already pick five, so kind of stopping the wheeling considerations, but if I was to end with Elspeth in my pile, she'd probably make it into the deck. All right, Wandering Emperor. Don't mind if I do. All right, so what am I looking for? I'm looking for maybe open a Mox or a Mana Crypt. Maybe pick up a Stoneforge Mystic or Swords to Plowshares. Some of those premium cheap cards. We're still looking for the Adeline or the Gideon to wheel, but I think I'm going to have a pretty nice mono white deck. So once you know you can get mono white and get, you know, 23, 24 pretty good cards, you just start to think about, like, let's lower the curve and replace those four drops with good cards that cost one or two mana. Skullclamp's nice for those purposes. Dismember would be nice too, but I like Skullclamp even more. Big Elishnorn. Is there any matchup where I would like sideboard this in, for example? Probably not, but also probably not any way that I'm going to get to like a splash color. I don't know. Maybe if I get a Soul Ring, this becomes an interesting card or something like that. All right, well, Gideon, Adeline, and Sword of Fire and Ice all wheeled. I think, man, Gideon used to be like one of my favorite cards in the queue, but I think, Power Creep has affected Gideon's value a little bit, and I'm just going to take the cheaper card. Adeline is totally awesome. See if Parallax Wave wheels. Or Mishra's Factory. Or Elspeth Knight Errant. Yeah, in pack three, give me a Mox or a Mana Crypt, and I'm a happy camper. Sometimes these white decks can be a little bit underpowered, but you know what? Any draft where you don't get a power card is a little bit underpowered. And this is definitely a way that you can steal games against more powerful decks. I don't think I care about any of these cards. So anyway, the Avalanche Riders becomes part of a sideboard plan. I don't think so. All right, Mishra's Factory or Lurrus. Lurrus is amazing if I get Black Lotus. I think I'm just gonna get over the finish line in terms of number pl of playables. So I think the marginal upgrade from Plains to Mishra's Factory is gonna be larger than the marginal upgrade of, Wandering Emperor to Lurrus or whatever it might be, Elspeth to Lurrus. All right, we're doing pretty good. Ooh, Caracas. Similarly, the marginal upgrade of Plains to Caracas is quite large. I think that's a slam dunk pick here. Blade Splicer. This is another one where, power creep and having access to cards like Adeline has changed the value of Blade Splicer, but I imagine this would still make my deck given that I have Flicker Wisp and Restoration Angel. But it will probably wheel. All right. Guardian of Gyarapur. That's a new one. And it seems good. Oust or Mishra's Bauble would be fine, but I'm going to take the Angel. I guess the dream of getting a Mox or a Mana Crypt is not going to happen this time, so I'll have to play my lands one at a time, just like everybody else. Yeah, Containment Priest is nice. This is 21 cards here. We'll see about the balance. All right, Swords to Plowshares, Stoneforge Mystic. I guess I did miss out on Mother of Runes. That was in the first pack, and I took Solitude over it. Student of Warfare. Okay, Path to Exile or Spectral Procession, or actually Strip Mine. I think Strip Mine is the best of them. Armageddon would be nice. Ooh, Thalia and Elite Spellbinder. Now, sometimes Thalia actually does more harm than good. Let's have a quick look. All of my three drops are creatures, which is good. I have some Planeswalkers at four. But yeah, I think Thalia is just great as a two drop here. Probably a little better than Elite Spellbinder. Given my value lands, I probably will play 17 lands here, so this is 21 cards, still looking for two more. If the draft ended now and I tossed in Balance and Elesnorn, that would be fine, but two more cheap cards would be great. I love a Wasteland and don't care about Enlightened Tutor, so that's easy enough. I don't think there's any way I get to 18 lands even with Strip Mine and Wasteland. I think 17 is just probably the right number. I do not have Stoneforge Mystic, so I'm not particularly interested in Batterskull. I'll take the March and maybe sideboard it, but we'll see. The draft was to end now, it would make my deck.
Like, I
So one more unseen pack to get Stoneforge Mystic, Swords to Plowshares, Student of Warfare, Ephemerate, Tithe Taker, and Sword of Feast and Famine. I think I'm inclined towards Tithe Taker. Yeah, that's a good card. Ephemerate goes with Recruiter of the Guard, White Plume Adventurer. Yeah, I'm gonna take Tithe Taker. Yeah, that's 23. If I get one more card, I'll move the March to my sideboard. See if the Blade Splicer wheels, because I could cut Restoration Angel. But yeah, Blade Splicer wheeled. With Containment Priest, you can Flicker Wisp an opposing creature to just kill it outright. Also, Parallax Wave with Containment Priest is pretty sweet. So yeah, I imagine this is just my deck. If I get another playable, maybe I cut the Elspeth with the tiebreaker that Thalia is making it more expensive. Yeah, Oust I think is good. So, Oust in, Elspeth out. I think your mono white deck is pretty good if you're cutting Elspeth. Like, this is just a good card. Right. Don't think I'm using any of these. Wow, the Path and the Spectral Procession both wield. Sure, Path to Exile, and now I just don't even know what to cut. Emperor? Oh my god, I'm just getting everything. All right, so the Restoration Angel pairs with Recruiter of the Guard, White Plume Adventurer, Blade Splicer, Elite Spellbinder. It saves my stuff from removal. All that I think is just enough. So maybe I cut some of the expensive stuff that's getting taxed by Thalia. First thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna add 12 planes. Now I need to make two pretty challenging cuts. I imagine Path to Exile is going to make it. Tithe Taker. All right. So let's say no to March. No to Elspeth. Path, Oust, expensive cards. I feel like I want to play Parallax Wave. Feel like I want to play Path to Exile. So then that gives me one out of these three. It might just be like crazy to cut Elspeth Conqueror's Death, but it is my most expensive card. And I think the plan here is I want to just like get ahead and then Wasteland and Strip Mine them. So a card that's going to sometimes cost me 6 mana when I want to be using Wasteland and Strip Mine, I guess I can cut that. But yeah, I mean, I just got every mono white card in the draft, pretty much, minus the Mother of Ruins and the Palace Jailer that I picked other things over. I think this is a good deck. I think this is about as good as you can ask for when you don't get a power card in any of the packs. And yeah, stick with me. I'll be back for match number one. All right, here we go for match number one. My opening hand is excellent. Let's do it. Touche. I'm going to go with Caracas Pass. Just trying to play the White Bloom Adventurer before I start trading off lands. Okay. Okay, I think this is gonna work out. I'm gonna play the White Plume, take the initiative. If they go for an unblockable attack, then I can blow them out with Solitude. If they just go for pumping the figure to 4/4, then I'll chump block and then use Solitude and Wandering Emperor or Parallax Wave or whatever to clean the board and maintain the initiative. All right, this is interesting. But it will still be okay. Yep. Yep. So now I'm gonna just pass with the intent to play Wandering Emperor because I need to get a creature on the battlefield to take the initiative back. Parallax Wave actually like pretty great answer to Giver of Runes. Yep. Taking six. Okay, so it's gonna be Parallax Wave, Exile Giver, attack with Samurai Token, get back initiative, Parallax Wave the figure. Yeah. I guess I could have responded to that with Parallax Wave, but it's fine. I can also just wave it when they attack. The big question is, do they have a way to kill the Samurai token? They do. They're gonna fire blast the Samurai token. All right. Consider me fire blasted. So now I strip what, the mountain? Yep, trap takes me down to four, but they really don't have a lot left to work with. Artifact or creature. Recruiter for Thalia seems pretty good here. Or recruiter for Containment Priest. But I do feel like Thalia is going to stop a lot of the ways that they could get back into the game. Containment Priest, Thalia. Yeah, let's do Thalia. All right. So bringing in the March, the Oust. Mean, could just go a little bigger. I think White Plume Adventurer is probably too good to cut, even on the draw in an aggro All right, we're going bigger. Just cutting all the like grizzly bear type creatures and trying to win with big stuff. Elishnorn might be like a little too much. But I think I'll try it. If they have like Armageddon or something in their deck, then I'll certainly board it out for game three. But I'm gonna feel like a genius if I win with Elishnorn. Sounds good to me. I think I can wait on playing the Chrome Mox. Huh. Right, March. March the Phoenix, March the Giver. Probably just March the Giver. I can pass. End of turn, March the Giver, and then Chrome Mox, land, Wandering Emperor of the Phoenix. Yee. Well, at least Parallax Wave's good against the token. Okay, I think I'm in for land, Mox, imprint, oust, play Parallax Wave. That is a full value Fable of the Mirror Breaker, discarding two planes. Hellrider. Get just the Hellrider, I guess. Emperor, Exile the Phoenix. So if I play ECD, then I might not get value on chapter three, which I really want to get value on chapter three. Like, it would be awesome if they just lightning bolt the Wandering Emperor. That would be a great outcome for me. A little bit annoying, though I can Parallax Wave it if I want. No, I guess I can't because it would be back. in play before the ECD pops off. Once again, only creature or artifact. All right. I guess I'm gonna just play a Guardian and a Jitte and hope it works out. So if something gets really dicey, I can remove the last counter from the Parallax Wave. It's a close game. Fable of the Mirror Breaker is no joke. Okay. But I may connect with Umezawa's Jitte. Unless they have like Fire Blast or a way to kill the Guardian. Do you have Fire Blast? So I think I want to equip and attack. Well, let's see. If I equip and attack, but basically, like, would I rather waste, assuming they have Fire Blast, would I rather waste a counter, an activation of the Wandering Emperor, or would I rather waste the two mana that it costs to equip the Jitte? Flicker Wisp my Parallax Wave. That's a really good play. So, yeah, I'm gonna equip, try to attack, and then have the plan of making a samurai and flicker wisping the parallax wave. Right. Land, Samurai, Flicker the Parallax Wave. So Hellrider comes back, but that's should be manageable once the wave comes back as well. All right. So they're going to take back the initiative. That's a really good play. They're scrying two, because they probably need to find an answer to the Jitte. Hellrider's back. Parallax Wave is back. I think I'm just going to pass and keep maximum flexibility with my Parallax Wave counters and my Jitte counters. I do think it would be reasonable just kill the reflection with the with minus two, minus two. I guess I'll see if they invest mana on the Lion Sash. So I could kill that now for the price of one counter. Does mean leaving the reflection, but I can Parallax Wave whatever they target with reflection. So I'm going to take that. I think it's just a bargain, basically. Kill the Lion Sash for one counter. Stash, create a treasure. You got it. Right. I think I need to get rid of the Hellrider before combat because it does make it too easy for them to kill the Wandering Emperor at no cost. So beginning of combat. Maybe this is bad. I probably should have gotten rid of the reflection in some form a lot earlier than this, but I'll start by targeting the reflection. They're going to target the Hellrider. I wanted to exile that anyway, so that's fine. Then let's hope to get the game over with before the Parallax Wave runs out of counters again. I should take note, what did they do with the scry? One top, one bottom. So if they want to just make these trades, that's perfectly fine with me. If they want to pump the figure, then I'll exile it with Parallax Wave, because it at least takes their full turn. All right, Stomp Wandering Emperor, you got it. The Lion Sash is dead now, so I can get full value with the ECD. Stoneforge Mystic. They've already gone through Lion Sash. Got other cool stuff. Sword of Fire and Ice. Sure. So I just drew mountain, which means they play Bone Crusher Giant. I go to the trap. I remove the Bone Crusher Giant. I attack for, you know, at least 12 damage. Yep. Take your pick. Take your favorite method of lethal here. All right, that felt good. Parallax Wave is awesome in those types of creature matchups, as is Umezawa's Jitte. And the deck's feeling good. I'll see you for round number two. Hey, welcome back. Picking up where I left off with match number two of this mono-white Vintage Cube draft. I am on the draw, but I like my hand. So the importance of having some good cheap plays, including Figure of Destiny, the scalable one drop. I've always been willing to spend a high pick on Figure of Destiny because it's a really good one drop that can go in either mono white or mono red. So that's a way to keep yourself open to a couple of good aggro options without just kind of closing your eyes and committing to something. Pack one, pick one. All right. Well, this looks like a Niv-Mizzet deck if I've ever seen one. And it also looks like a Niv-Mizzet deck with a really good start. So what do I want to do? Just play out the Jitte, play the Tithe Taker. I probably want to curve into Adeline, so maybe like... All right, don't want to play the factory because I want to be threatening the Figure of Destiny. So just attack and play Tithe Taker. All right. Well, my Magic Online seems to be having some trouble today. The game chat says they're casting Fable of the Mirror Breaker, but the image has not updated yet. There we go. Okay. So option A, play Adeline, attack with everything, then the goblin blocks the figure. The Sylvan blocks the Tithe Taker, so I get in one damage and I downgrade a figure into a token. Option B, just play Adeline, do nothing. Option C would be like either Vanguard plus Pump Figure or Jitte plus Pump Figure. I like playing Adeline because then I have two creatures that can profitably block the Goblin Shaman. Then yet another question is, do I want to take pain from the Horizon Canopy so that all my lands can produce white? I think it's fine to just play Mistress Factory and Adeline and pass. I do not feel like I'm winning this game because my opponent has all this mana and all these colors, and now the Fable is going to guaranteed dig them to something scary that will make life very hard on me. And on top of everything, they're still at 20, which is way too much life for me to be able to steal a game with with an aggressive attack. All right, got to be careful about casting the Jitte into the Dak Faden. Wow, that's a lot of lands. I'm just going to play Plains and attack the Planeswalker with everything. And then have the Wandering Emperor in case I need to win combat. Like a natural block would be the Goblin blocking either the figure or the token, the Sylvan blocking the Tithe Taker. Sure, I think. Firing off Wandering Emperor and winning the fight against the Goblin Shaman, that's going to be a good outcome for me. There he is. There he is. Wow, is that they fully bricked? Island, Plains, Trinket Mage, Ugin, Channel, Golgari Signet, Factor Fiction, Forest, Simic Signet, Court of Bounty. They got nothing. They played a land that doesn't even tap for mana. They just have one card left in hand. So even after all that filtering with Fable and Dak and Niv-Mizzet, they may not have a very strong hand or position right now. Meanwhile, what am I going to do? Adeline can actually attack in and threaten to trade against Niv-Mizzet. None of my other creatures can. I can't really protect my Wandering Emperor from the Niv, assuming they choose not to block Adeline. I guess what I could do is get some counters on the Jitte and bump this up to five, but that's really spending a lot of resources to protect the Emperor. Okay. Can't copy the legendary creature. That's a saving grace here. And then it does have Exalted. So yeah, I'm gonna scrap the plan of trying to protect the Emperor. So I can cash it in to either exile the Noble Hierarch or just make another 2/2. I think I'm going to go Plains, Jitte, equip, make a 2/2, attack with. Well, maybe I should just attack with everything because the Niv-Mizzet has a free block on the token anyway. So, all right. Here goes. And then I could then equip this to anything. But equipping to Adeline makes sense because unless there's a one mana removal spell, she's going to survive combat. Oh, you know what I could do is I could kill my own Tithe Taker and make a 1/1 flying blocker. That's maybe interesting. All right, so I can't save this. So actually, the best I can do is just activate Mishra's Factory and get in one additional damage from Adeline. So these counters, they can kill my Tithe Taker if I wanted to trade a bunch of resources to block Niv-Mizzet and have Wandering Emperor survive. Can kill Reflection. Maybe I should have just killed the Noble Hierarch right away. So the thing that's interesting about blocking the Emperor is that I can then minus two and exile the Niv-Mizzet, but I don't know. My opponent just, I think their draw just didn't cooperate that game. That felt like a game I should not have been in at all. Like turn two Caryatid, turn three Fable, and then a quick Niv-Mizzet. But they just, even after all that effort, they just didn't have a good hand. But I guess we'll take it. So the March, they did have a bunch of Signets. That's not really a great play of spending three mana to exile a Signet. Elspeth Conqueror's Death, probably going to be fine because it is sort of just like a mid-range deck with permanents that I'm going to be able to target with that. Oust. Do I really want to be ousting a Niv-Mizzet? I can oust a Goblin Shaman token. I'm inclined to just bring in the Elspeth Conqueror's Death and then probably not much else. I want to be fast for sure. The Containment Priest seems like it's not that great, though it does pair with Flicker Wisp and Parallax Wave. Guess that's a fine one for one. I do have Wasteland and Strip Mine, which that's of course just great in the matchup. Karaka's pretty good too. Yeah, this hand is a little awkward, but I'm gonna keep it. One thing I could do is just pitch the Path to Exile to Chrome Mox and power out a quick Blade Splicer. See how that serves me. Urza's Saga. Well, if I'd known about that, then maybe I should bring in the March of Otherworldly Light. Okay. Do I pitch something and power out the Jitte? Or do I just wait on that? I guess I'll just wait. And then the other question is, do I play the Caracas? And any chance they're going to play like a Ragavan? I think I'm just on Plains Go. Yep. Right. All right, pitching Selfless Spirit and then play the Blade Splicer. Flicker Wisp can get the Blade Splicer, can also just exile the construct that they're going to make. So that's a high value card. I could continue to wait and not use the Chrome Mox, but I think I like Blade Splicer here. Yep. See if you have another target besides the Mox Ruby. Woo, two Moxen. Could double block. Suppose I'll just take it. No land drop from the opponent. So here comes Plains, Flicker the untapped construct. I think that's better than flickering Blade Splicer because then I don't have to use Path to Exile against a mana screwed opponent. They hit their land drop, but they're still missing a lot of colors. No green, notably. Yep. Just path my own creature in response. I should have factored the deck in more when I was sideboarding. Like maybe the Jitte comes out, even though it is a really powerful card, and it's even going to be good this game. But yeah, this does move the needle on how good my artifacts are going to be. Planeswalker player. I didn't even know that card was in the cube. Paradoxical Outcome. All right. You have Paradoxical Outcome. Well, if we're to go to game three, I'm definitely bringing in March of Otherworldly Light. I'm gonna reconsider some of these artifacts. I should have killed this before the other artifacts came back down. That was significant error. Plus two. Plus two. Caracas protects Adeline if need be. Channel is not very effective when you have four life. All right, we've done it. I'll see you for the third and final match. Right, friends, I'm 2-0 this Vintage Cube draft, which means that this one. It's for all the marbles, playing for a league trophy. And yeah, this hand is fine enough. I would love to draw a third land on time, but I think I'm going to use this exile path to the Chrome Mox, power out Selfless Spirit. If I draw a third land, my hand is perfect. If not, I can use Skullclamp to dig a little further. So yeah, happy with this. Coming in. All right, I'm just gonna get the Skullclamp going because if I can hit my land drops, I'll just kind of bury my opponent in card advantage. It's not the land drop I was hoping for, but I'll take it. Yep. I don't mind the Skuller because my cards are pretty redundant here. Like, they can take my best creature, I'll just play the second best one. By the way, my opponent rocking the 45 card deck. So either figure and equip or just play Blade Splicer and pass. Go like that option. Might actually work out okay for me. Okay. So I certainly want to take the initiative, which probably means using Solitude to remove a blocker. Could just play the Adeline. I think that makes a lot of sense too. So my opponent knew about Adeline in my hand, still chose to make this play. Do they have a Solitude of their own? All right. I'm gonna go cast Adeline, play Caracas, declare my attack so that I get the Adeline trigger, and then Solitude the White Plume. Man, Adeline plus Skullclamp is that is a nice one. Right, so I could clamp something or just hold up the Caracas for Adeline, which that actually does make sense because my opponent would have to remove the Adeline in order to take initiative. So I think on balance, I'm just going to choose to pass. That one's not super effective against me. I think I actually want this human to stay as a 1/1, so I'm going to forge onto my Golem. Or the Adeline. I mean, Adeline's protected against. Yeah, I'll forge onto the Adeline. Fire up the factory. Go like that. They block the token, but that's a lot of damage. That's 13 coming through. Skullclamp this other token. Plains, Giver of Runes, and opponent's going to need something pretty special here. Also have Trap coming. All right, one game away from a trophy. Think this is probably another good matchup for Elspeth Conqueror's Death. Maybe oust. And then I kind of wanted to go like moderately bigger in the matchup. Possible cuts be like Elite Spellbinder, Containment Priest, Vanguard, Selfless Spirit, Tithe Taker, Usher of the Fallen, especially when I'm on the draw. Elspeth could be good too. I'm not going to go quite as deep as Elishnorn because my opponent is it they're in removal colors, so it's stands to reason I could wait all game, cast Elishnorn, and they just Hero's Downfall. Kind of like the Containment Priest. All right, let's try this. Is this the configuration that's going to get me over the finish line? It's a good hand. It's a very good hand. So if I can get this out and then strip mine them, that's really good. I mean, it would be totally fine to just strip mine and play figure. Yeah, might even be a little greedy to do anything besides strip mine. Let me think about this a little more. Yeah, I don't think I think it's not a spot to get greedy. Just fire off the strip mine, play another creature. I'm so far ahead here. We boasting or are we playing Jitte? I think I'm boasting. Just go wide and then take the initiative and I'll be in great shape. Uh-oh. Yep. So forging onto the Usher of the Fallen looks pretty good at face value. So Wastelanding Ancient Tomb is fine, though with that life total, like they might not be able to tap Ancient Tomb again anyway. There's Jitte and equip, there's Recruiter, and I could get Solitude, but I can't cast that yet. But that's probably fine. Like, how about I go attack with Usher, then Recruiter for Solitude and Wasteland you. Then I won't necessarily be able to cast the Solitude the next turn, but I'll still be set up pretty well. Though another thing I could do, if I don't wasteland them and they tap the Ancient Tomb, then all I have to do is get rid of the Angel, even like Flicker Wisp it. Then I take the initiative again and I do trap. But let's just, yeah, I mean, maybe Flicker Wisp is better than Solitude. Because if I'm on the wasteland plan, which I don't have to be on the wasteland plan, then I could just draw another Plains and be unable to cast the Solitude. Like, if I draw a white card, I could always Flicker Wisp the Recruiter and then get a Solitude. Okay, I think I've talked myself into getting Flicker Wisp. And I am gonna wasteland just because you never know. Like, my opponent could play some crazy card or some life gain spell. Okay, you're gonna need something pretty special. You need to kill all my creatures and stay at six life. Not give me back the white plume. Okay, my opponent typed GG's in the chat, which I think that means that this is going to be another trophy. Nice little 3-0 in matches, 6-0 in games. Really clean, effective white weenie deck. And the strip mine in the wasteland certainly didn't hurt either. All right, I hope you enjoyed this video. I will see you next time here on channelfireball.com.